Good afternoon, and welcome back. Today, I am going to be working on a model that I actually did quite a while ago, but we never got around to actually producing it. This one was done back in when we were just starting to look into the original plastics. I think we had the original 8 in the white plastic at the time. And, that model is the Hind, which I know people have been asking for a long time. And now seems like the time. So, back then, as we were looking at those plastics, they were fairly flimsy, so I had to design these extremely thick rotor blades to sort of combat that. So here we, as I prepare this for final production, I'm going to thin the blades down because the plastic process we're using, the dual cast, is a lot more rigid. So we can get away with more proportional blades here. And I also have to break them up into what their final parts are going to be, how it's going to be packaged and such. And we're starting with an initial size of about 90 millimeters for the fuselage from the front of the gun back to the very tip of this vertical stabilizer there. And you might notice, you see all the detail here, but as I rotate it around, it kind of seems to flatten out and disappear. That's because the detail is just an image that's projected on the model through a process called UV unwrapping. This is one of the processes that I developed for myself, which is more like traditional movie and animation game model type design, where I will design the texture in Photoshop and then wrap it around the object. So here these details are all just projected. So if I go here just to the fuselage portion and turn the texture off, it all disappears. Now the nice thing about projecting details like this is that I can go back in Photoshop and change them without having to do any fixing on the model itself in ZBrush. So if I didn't like how these vents turned out, I wouldn't have to either go back to a previous version, roll back my undo levels. I could just go into, or just sculpt them out and then sculpt new details in. I could just go back to Photoshop and delete that part of the image and put something different in. So this is the Hind, which is a DT6 model, I believe. And it has a medium MRAC and two light rocket, is it 15s? And two light rocket 5s. I suppose since the 5 little nubs I got on there. It's not a bad little flyer. So first I'm going to address those rotors. That rotor capstan looks like it's got a diameter of approximately 5.7 millimeters. That's a nice, healthy, beefy part. We're going to be separating the blades, which will work better for casting and packaging. So I'll need to create little sockets for these to plug into. So you need a lot of meat to plug those things in. So this is almost 3.5 millimeters. I can get away with a smaller cap, smaller post than that, I believe. I might bring those down to 3 millimeters and see what that looks like. Let's see where this sits in the world. So it's a little off the center of the world. Gonna move this piece towards the origin of the world to make my life a little easier, but I need to record where its position is so I can move back. We'll see if that works when the time comes. Yeah, that gives us a nice 3 millimeter post. definitely think the thinner blades will look better here. I should not have done that. I just lost all my texture information. But I can get it back. Thank you. Hey Gimli, how you doing? Yeah, it does actually exist. Hey, Ilmarin. How are you doing? No complaints. You're not trying hard enough. those who've joined late, what I'm doing here is I am going through a model that I actually designed quite some time ago and getting into it into shape for the dual cast process. So the first thing I did was I narrowed the blades. They were almost four millimeters thick. So since the dual cast is much more rigid than the original plastics that we were using, I was able to slim that down to about 2 millimeters thick. I reduced the posts down to about 3 millimeters. And I'm designing how these things come apart so they can be cast and then put back together proper, like we hope. And the idea here is that, where are we going? Is that the capstan would have one of the blades permanently attached to it, and then two post holes for the other two blades. Of course, since there are two sets of them and they're stacked, I can't have them exactly the same. There has to be an upper set and a lower set, because one of them's going to have a hole through it for the top one to set into. Yeah, it's kind of a combination between the hind and the hip. The rotor size on these helicopters is absolutely enormous, so we couldn't do a full-size one and have, what is it, like 8 blades on it, so we decided to go with this design. Because the hip is a pretty cool design as well. Well, that Ilmrim, that would work, except that introduces an additional piece, and we're trying to keep the part count down as low as we can. I mean, you're going to have to cast all the blades in one shot anyway. It's just the most efficient for production, so it's not a big deal to have them different. It's only the slight annoyance of assembly where that can be a problem. But as somebody invariably is going to accidentally glue the top rotor to the hull before looking at the where the bottom rotor is supposed to go and realize that they can't put it in top. So it'd be nice to avoid those situations and make them identical, but we're not building for those tiny minorities that won't be paying attention, shall we say? The real problem is having enough meat in that center nut that doesn't interfere with the posting of the blades going to it, and so we'll see if that works. I guess it's better to say it would be convenient if they were identical, but certainly not necessary. 2 millimeters. Yep, spot on. And we'll see how badly this interferes. Oh! Those are going to be thin walls. 0.2 millimeter. Maybe I can get an extra 1/10 out of that. Yeah, that's almost 0.3 millimeter. So we'll make a 2 millimeter deep hole. Actually, I'm going to lose that 1/10 because the hole is going to have to be slightly bigger than the post. I don't know, a bigger scale. Would certainly look cool, but there's trade-offs, aren't there? Bigger scale means more expensive figures. Maybe we should take this and make an a fixed wing aircraft version of it as well. These are a pretty cool shape. Take these wings and blow them up. Pretty awesome aircraft. That looks a little thin there on top. Yeah, that's only just a little over 1/10 of a millimeter of wall thickness there. So I'm gonna have to separate these blades a little bit more. Yeah, put tilt rotors on it. Hopefully that works. I'm a little concerned with these nacelles and how they attach. There's lots of little slivers of areas all around it that can lead to a mechanical lock in the mold. I can backfill most of that, alleviate that problem, but it kind of comes and collides with this wing. Might need to do something about that. And John can hype up about that. These frame of these the cockpit windows might be a little thin. I'm measuring it at about a little over 0.3 millimeter. That might need some addressing. All right, here's what the UVs look like when they are unwrapped, flattened out. So you can see the those two wings, the intakes, center, those the cells. Then of course here's the two canopy windows. That's what I'm interested in. Find which layer put that detail on. Must be it. Alright, so basically all I needed to do was to thicken these up was to add an effects filter on it, which was just draw a line around the object, which is just a stroke fill. And then I add a little blur around the ends to make sure that the transitions are good. Get away from a little bit of the jagginess. Oops. I need to unlock that. Alright, we saved that out. And go to where I've got the canopy glass. Go down to the displacement map and import the updated one. There we go. Just a wee bit thicker. That'd do it. So you see with that process of using UV unwrapping, I can pretty easily make changes to the underlining texture. That's completely non-destructive to the model itself. Had I sculpted all of this framework in there and then decided that it was too thin, I'd have to come in here and either nudge them or rebuild it. Wipe out the existing detail and rebuild new detail on top of it. But with mapping, just gotta draw it in. The next question I have is about its weapons loadout. And the gun, that will probably cast just fine. There's no big undercuts anywhere. This slight one in here, that'll be easy to fill in on both sides, but there's no real big details in there that would necessitate the gun being separate. Unless, of course, John wants it separate, then separate it'll be. Now these rocket pods, since they're hanging under, depending on how soft the model is, it's rather a large mounting point I've got on it. So there'd probably be no problem with them popping out along their side edges, but this length here in front and behind, that would also grab the mold. That's just a little over a millimeter in the back. so that's probably not a big deal. But it's 5 millimeters, it'd be buried in the nose. That might cause a lot of wear and tear on the mold. So that would be a John decision. One of the things I could do to alleviate that is to bury it further up into that winglet. That way the mold line can come down through it a little bit more. All it needs to do is come down and cut right across the top of it, go around the wing, and then cut across the back of it. So if it was buried into the wing, I don't think that would be difficult to do, but because it hangs down entirely, these might have to be separate pieces. And of course, if they are to be separate pieces, then they might as well hang down more so you can see more of the mounting post, that hard point. So I'm going to move along and deal with these nacelles, and hopefully John might chime in about what to do about those rocket pods. Well, that wasn't too difficult to backfill that. Something that might have to be removed all these little dots here, that the thought behind those was countermeasures. The original design was supposed to have countermeasures. But I do not see that in the final version of this model. So might have to wipe those out. Or keep them in because they look kind of cool. Yet another John decision. Oh, wow. So the Photoshop has remained persistent. All right, there. I've disabled it entirely. Sorry about that. Anyway, there's the thickened windows. I think I can use the undo history to show you the difference. Okay, there's how they originally were, and that's just me bumping it up a tad bit. Oh, hey, James. How's your Saturday going? Here I modified the shape of the inside of these nacelles to make sure that there were no more voids going through the model. Pokemon. All right. Alright, so John has made a decision on the nacelle, on the rocket pods. And he says, and I quote, "Whichever way you think looks best." So, personally, I think since the Hind has obvious hard points with the rockets mounted to them, that that's the way I will go. So they will be separate pieces. It's more work, but I think we come out with a better looking product. Down to a single part so they're easier to move. be good enough. Ilmarin, that's a very good question. How it's going to go is where there's enough meat to actually incorporate the whole. So since we're dealing with a wing here that's probably about 2.5 millimeters thick where the post goes, the post will probably be attached to the wing, which is pretty much how the actual Hind does it. And all other attack helicopters is the hard points mounted to the wing, and then there'll be a hole in the rocket launcher for the post to go into. A 2 millimeter thick hard point should do well enough. Well, that's another potential solution to have the wing socketed into the main body. A much more difficult connection to design and create. Ultimately, I don't think it's necessary. Since the mold is flexible, this angle in here is not extreme. So I think it would be quite easy for that mold line to come along this ridge and then just go up to the wing, down around it, out the back, and then drop down right there on that line, come down the whatever the hell these little wings are called, and then down out its tail. Or might come up to the ridge of this little protrusion right here. Then up along this one, and then down the wing, and the tail as before. That might be an easier way to go, but not really my decision. If it doesn't work, they can yell at me later. Progress. And making that hole into the rockets is fairly easy. I'll just use the hard point, duplicate that, and there's a deformation. And I will inflate that part. See about that much. And use that as basically an object to cut into the rocket itself. So the post will go up into the hull section. Gun will be moved up into the hull section as well. There. Nice holes in the rocket launcher. That post to go into. Should be real easy to glue up. So there's the Hind with its bare hard points. Which I'm sure that's going to be a really easy conversion for any variant that doesn't have those rocket pods. Alright, I think everything is where it ought to be, so I should probably apply all these textures to it and see what needs to be cleaned up after that. Once again, save the progress. Yeah, that's probably not the best option for a helicopter. To be in short range of anything, I can shoot at it anyway. But, you know, back in the back lines, if you got some unprotected indirect fire machines back there, the Hind with a pair of PBGs could wreak some havoc. Yeah, I know they're immune to indirect fire, but indirect fire machines usually don't have weaponry that can shoot down aircraft. So if they're not protected, might be a good hit and run. But at 6 DTs, I don't know, seems kind of expensive. Oh. Sorry, James. So I'll apply the textures to this blade first. And one of the issues that I run into is if I have a line that's supposed to cut into the object like this one does, and it wraps around a very thin corner, what'll happen is the polygons will go in and they will cross each other. So you'll have this point where this part of the model is turned inside out because of how far the polygons move and clash. So I'm definitely gonna have to clean up this corner, possibly this one, but maybe not, because it's a rounded edge that might survive. Of course, one might ask why you have panel lines going through a helicopter blade regardless, but I just thought it looked cool. So, subdivide it to a ridiculous level. Let me change material so it's a little more apparent. And then apply the displacement map. That's quite a severe cut. So you see here where the polys sort of passed each other. And you've got this weird shape there. That's now going to complicate your final product. But looking at this, that makes rather a narrow part. See how thick that is. Yeah, that's only a little more than a millimeter thick at that point. That's a bad break point. So I'm going to decrease the amount of effect that the displacement maps has on the model and reapply it. And see what it looks like with a shallower channel. Yeah, there's 1.5 millimeters. And I think those channels are still deep enough. To show up, catch paint and all that lovely stuff. Oops, that turned out too soft. These should have a crease on them. That looks better. So there's one of my blades. If you look closely, this thing is Got a lot of polys. So 3.5 million polys just for this one blade. And that's pretty unacceptable. So I go to Decimation Master. And the first thing you do is you pre-process it. Where I assume it goes through and it makes a mathematical formulation for the shape itself. This part takes a long time. Pre-processing for Decimation Master is a little inconvenient if you know exactly what you're going to decimate it to. However, if you're not sure and you need to try different settings, pre-process basically allows you to change the amount of decimation very quickly. It's just the one long processing point up front, and then any fudging you do after that is very quick. Whereas if you didn't pre-process it, it would take a lot longer if you had to do it more than once. So, interesting trade-off. So let's see, decimate it down to about, let's say, 10%. There's not a whole lot of detail in it, just the two lines and these little protrusions. So it'll keep a lot of polys in these more rounded areas and these long flat areas. It'll remove a lot of those polys from. So let's see what that looks like. So now we're down to about a little less than 900,000 polys. So went from 3.5 million to 900,000. That's quite a dip. Still an awful lot of polys for such a small part, so I'm going to reduce that down to 5%. And this is where the pre-process comes in handy, because you just click it again. And it does its little magic dance. So now we're down to 560,000. And everything looks good. So I'll see how much further I can go. See what 1% looks like. This is usually too far. But I did not see any movement, so... Looks like 1% is a winner. So 65,528 polys. Started out at 3.5 million. And all my details are still there. So that's a winner. Now it's made of wood. Whew. Don't think I would trust that helicopter. Okay, boop. See that capstan pop right out of there. Now this little stair-stepping is interesting. The reason that happens is that the texture map... those are basically different levels of gray in the model. And there's only so many levels of gradation you can have in an image. So that's why it reflects down here now. Of course, at size, you're never going to see it. So it's at its actual size, it looks really, really smooth. Close up. Now it looks like wood. And of course, if it really is bothersome, you can always try and smooth it out. Oh, I still have dynamic subdivisions on. There we go. There. But, of course, for us, unnecessary. It'll even if it does show up in the final model, any pigment is just going to fill it right in. Because that's really a micro surface. In fact, I probably didn't need to subdivide it to 7 levels. Could probably just done it with 6 and been just fine. Alright, so decimate at 1%. Wow, it still preserved a lot of that, didn't it? Let's see what this looks like at 20,000 polys. It's been decimated. You can always go in and do more if you want. There's a lot less of it, but you can still see where the polys folded in on themselves. So now you can see I turned off double-sided, so you're looking at the inside of the model out. So how do I go about getting rid of that? And the easiest way I found is to use the Sculptress, which is kind of a retopolizing tool. Whereas you as you draw over it, it'll add polygons in as it reforms the shape. And what this does to these really thin parts is it'll kind of like melt them away like a blowtorch to butter. And just like that, it's gone. Have to carry this up into the wing area to make sure it's entirely gone, but just like that, it's fixed. And unfortunately, all the blades are identical, so I don't need to make five more of those, so I'll just duplicate this one. And then the last part that needs to be done, the blade, the top blades. Oops. That's supposed to be subtracted, there we go. So, the second and third blade, they're complete. I don't need to do anything with them, I just need to unify these parts together for the capstan, and once I have them all subdivided and where I need them, it's pretty simple. Oops. Some input subtools are invalid. Play the mystery game. This can sometimes happen when parts are inside out. It looks fine. Don't see anything wrong. Okay, the problem is not in the capstan. See if I can fake it. No, the problem is definitely in the blade itself. Another thing that might cause this is a non-watertight or open form that might have a hole in it somewhere that I'm not seeing. So I'll hit close holes and see if that solves it. Nope. I think a sea stallion would be a really cool machine to make have. Well, if I can't figure it out, I have to recreate it. Oh yeah, definitely something wrong with this model. Oof. That's interesting. Alright, it seems I have some non-manifold geometry going on here. The spikes highlighted in red are where there are two faces that are occupying the same areas, same space. So, computer doesn't know what to do. That did it. Of course, the whole thing is red now because I have two identical objects that are occupying the same space. There will be the final part. It's usually not that difficult to get these parts to come together. Just having a little mystery like those coplanar surfaces. Fixing them usually isn't that big a deal, it's finding them. So, well, there's the finished blades. On one of the large flight bases. Not sure I've got the right size for this flight base. That looks a little large. Isn't that base only like 70 millimeters across? There's a 25 millimeter base. I don't know where mine are at the moment, so I can't measure it out, but doesn't really matter. That is definitely not right. That looks about right. Well, if your screen was the same size as mine, that would be actual size. Anyway, that's my time. So thank you for joining me. And hope you have a good rest of your weekend. I'll take care.